Okay, I wanted to go back. I always like to go back, and I get shorter and shorter. So I kind of race through because I want to tell you where I see where we are in this poem. And you remember in chapter 3, verse 6, that's where I think the wedding scene begins. And this is where the man refers to his love coming up from the wilderness. And as I mentioned, she's described that way, I believe, because the wilderness is looked at as a place of relative insecurity and want, and she's joining him and his household in a wedding. So she's coming in his perception from a place of relative insecurity and want, coming to him and his household. So he sees her coming that way, and for him, her arrival, it's absolutely riveting. Absolutely riveting. It's almost surreal. It's described as these columns of smoke approaching, and I was thinking of a dust storm that comes in, how just awesome it is. And so that's how her approach is described, and she's perfumed with the finest fragrances available. This is the time, as I read this, of the long-awaited and eagerly anticipated wedding. Then after this stunning description of the bride's approach, there's this sudden reference in chapter 3, verses 7 to 11, to Solomon's great bed. And the daughters of Zion, they're exhorted to consider his wedding day. And by implication, they're exhorted to consider what it would mean to become his wife. So, you know, here's this grand bed and his the soldiers and all that he has. And he says, look on him on his wedding day and reflect on what it would mean to become his wife. He certainly would provide wealth and security in abundance. You know, this is like marrying the top dog when it comes to those things. But one would be just another of the many of the wives and concubines with whom Solomon shares his bed. And so they're asked to reflect on that, whereas security and provision, they're part of marriage. They are not the essence of marriage. See, they're part of marriage, but not its essence. Its essence is the singular love and the exclusive commitment of a man and a woman, and nothing can make up for the absence of that. I don't care how much money you have, nothing can make up for the absence of those things. One can live comfortably without them. You can have all kinds of stuff. You can live that way, but one will never know the joy of having a soulmate for the journey of life. And so that's how I see the contrast being painted there. Then in chapter 4, verses 1 to 7, the man turns his attention back to the bride, and he speaks of her beauty and her sexual appeal, and he expresses his intention of enjoying her physically that night. This is their wedding, and he expresses that. And then in chapter 4, verse 8, through chapter 5, verse 1, we have this tasteful, poetic description of sexual intimacy on their wedding night. It's noted that the wife is a virgin, which confirms that the earlier allusions to sexual activity, remember earlier on some of the chapters where she's longing, and I said that's her just really thinking about this and longing, that confirms that they were portraits of longing and not actual fulfillment. So earlier in the poem, that's what's going on, where she's expressing her desire. Now we have the fulfillment of it. And in chapter 5, verses 2 to 8, we have another dream sequence, where her love, who's now her husband, he's traveled all through the night to get to her. Remember, he comes and he's covered in dew, and you say, well, she's her husband, why is he traveling? This is how dreams are. You know, so here he comes, he's traveled all night, that reflects his desire for her. He's covered in dew, and she teases him playfully, where he's trying to get to her, and she puts him off kind of thing, and she gets up to let him in, he's gone. That's again, that's the way it works in dreams. Now she hunts for him in the city, as she had done in the dream before they got married. But now the pain of separation is even worse than before, which as I read it, that's represented by her being beaten by the watchman. That aspect wasn't in the prior dream. And what I think is being said there, the point, as I suggested to you, is that having been sexually intimate in marriage, it has not diminished or eliminated their desire for each other, as though it was a case of been there, done that. See, that's not how it works. And the intimacy of marriage, it ideally intensifies desire for one another. So this is an idealized relationship. It is a poem, but that's how that would work. And then in chapter 5, 9 to 16, still in the dream, the daughters of Jerusalem, they ask the new wife, what's so special about her love? What's so special about her husband? And she just goes off. Well, he just looks amazing. He smells amazing. He's a delight to kiss. And as she says there in that section, he's altogether desirable. And beyond his physical attractiveness to her, he's her soulmate. She says her love and her friend. And that's parallel with how he calls her his sister. She's a sister, of course, in the sense that she's a fellow Israelite. But it's much more than that. He's talking about their relationship, how they get along and their bond together. So it's not just physical. There's this relationship that they share. And then in 6, 1 to 3, suddenly without explanation, again, as happens in dreams, this distressing separation is over, and the man and the woman, the husband and the wife, they're back together in sexual intimacy. So not only has marriage not diminished their love and their desire for each other, it's also freed them from the frustration that accompanied betrothal. If you remember seeing in the betrothal here, they had this burning, and yet it wasn't able to be satisfied because the time was not yet. But now you have that, so it doesn't extinguish that desire, and also in marriage, you don't have the frustration that exists in betrothal. Okay, all of that's where we've been. Okay, that may be too long, but that's what I wanted to give. Pick back up in 6, 4 to 10. The man speaks and he says, you are as beautiful as Tirzah, my darling, lovely as Jerusalem, awe-inspiring as an army with banners. Turn your eyes away from me, they overwhelm me. Your hair is like a flock of female goats flowing down from Mount Gilead. Your teeth are like a flock of sheep coming up from the washing place, all of them bearing twins. There is not a bereaved one among them. See, this reflects earlier. See, before their marriage, he hasn't lost his attraction for her. And he says, your cheek behind your veil is like a slice of pomegranate. There may be 60 queens and 80 concubines and virgins without number, but she is unique, my dove, my perfect one. She's unique to her mother, pure to her who bore her. The daughter saw her and called her blessed. The queens and concubines also, and they praised her. Who is this who looks down like the dawn, beautiful as the full moon, pure as the sun, awe-inspiring as an army with banners? So this is quite a description here where the man now, he returns her post-marriage adoration. Remember how she was set up in the dream where the daughters of Jerusalem said, what's so special about your guy? And she goes on and on. He's great, great smells, great, great kiss, wonderful, attractive in every way, wonderful. Well, he now returns that post-marriage adoration with that of his own. And as the New English Translation explains, he compares her to two of the most beautiful, important cities in the Israelite United Kingdom, namely Jerusalem and Tirzah. The beauty of Jerusalem was legendary. It is twice called the perfection of beauty. Tirzah was beautiful as well. In fact, the name means pleasure, beauty. So beautiful was Tirzah that it would be chosen by Jeroboam as the original capital of the northern kingdom. You see, we don't recognize some of that. So we see that, think it's silly, he compares her to a city, but in that culture, in that context, that was a compliment. Say, man, who are you going to go to? Jerusalem and Tirzah. So he's just basically saying she's a knockout. You see, he's telling her that she's a knockout. He describes her as awe-inspiring, breathtaking. You know, like a sight of an army spread across the land with their banners in full view. And you can see that. I thought of like when you first come to the rim of the Grand Canyon, the first time you've seen it. When you come up, and then all of a sudden it's like, whoa. And that's this picture, see, as you look out over this huge army that is spread out, this multitude with all these banners. And so he's getting at, she's awe-inspiring. Man, you look at her, she just take your breath away. She's, oh, man. You know, so he's just praising her. He's complimenting her. And though married, he has it so bad for her that he still melts when she looks at him. He still melts when she looks at him. The effect is so powerful that he asks her to turn her eyes away to keep from overwhelming him. And he's as taken as ever by the beauty of her hair, her white and symmetrical teeth, her rosy cheeks. And he then declares, in essence, that however many women the king may have, you know, king's got women hand over fist. However many he may have, he's still a loser to me. You see, however many women he has that the king has, none of them can hold a candle to his woman. I don't care. All these queens he's got maidens who serve him, he's got concubines. It's not about numbers. My bride is better than all of them. You see, she's better than all of them. He wishes he was in my shoes. And he's got all of these women, and none of them can match mine. She's one of a kind. Perfect woman in his eyes. Indeed, she's so outstanding that all the king's women, the maidens, the queens, the concubines, they confess her superiority. They wind up acknowledging and confessing that she's top dog. They acknowledge she's so far out of their league that they speak of her in terms of heavenly bodies. They wind up saying, in this context, by the way, the army here, when it says awe-inspiring, an army with banners, this is probably referring to the stars in procession marching across the sky, because this is all, these are heavenly descriptions. So this is in the poem, the king's women, who are acknowledging that he has it far better because his one trumps all of them by a mile. And so remember, he's returning her praise. And then in 6, 11, and 12, the woman says, I went down to the garden of nuts to see the blossoms of the valley, to see whether the vines had budded, whether the pomegranates were in bloom. I did not know my own desire. It has set me in a chariot with a noble man. Now I'll say a little bit about that last translation. The last verse is notoriously difficult, but I'll say a little bit about that. But here she says, she's moved by her man's, her husband's, her love's extravagant praise, and explores whether she feels the time is right for lovemaking. Now this is represented poetically by her assessing whether the sensual environment is properly stimulative. And you remember in chapter 2, maybe you don't remember, but in chapter 2, verses 12 and 13, you remember the man described the sensually pleasing springtime environment? He was going on and on about how the things were, you know, the sounds, the smells, it's springtime, everything's busting out. He winds up talking about that, and that was part of his appeal, you recall, to have her come with him. Is he saying, no, it's just perfect, everything's perfect, I want you to come away with me so I can look at you and talk. And that's when she balked and said, I think that's too temptation-laden. I mean, this isn't spelled out, but that's what I think is there in the sending him back. And so I just want you to see, when you look here, we're saying whether the vines had budded, whether the pomegranates were in bloom, I think what you have here is she's out assessing whether that the environment, the sensual environment, is properly stimulative. And she is surprised. In fact, she's surprised by the strength of her own desire. That tells me she presumably the time was indeed right for lovemaking. So she's caught up in this, and she says, okay, it surprised her, the strength of her own desire, and she then indicates her pleasure over the fact that her desire, now perhaps your desire more broadly conceived, in other words, not so narrowly focused on the sexual attraction aspect, although that's not left out, but just the idea, she indicates her pleasure over the fact that her desire has led her to unite with her love in marriage. It has set her in his chariot, so to speak. And this is a person she considers a noble man. Now, when it says a noble man, that's speaking of character. It isn't necessarily talking about nobility in the sense of royalty. And you can see here from the New International Dictionary of Old Testament Theology and Exegesis, that's a mouthful. He says, the word Nadib describes the noble man who counsels generous, noble things and possesses magnanimity of character. It also describes a heart that is generous, willing, even noble, such as was possessed by those who gave freely to the tabernacle and the temple when they were under construction. So she's delighted, you see, that her desire has brought her into union, she says, in his chariot with this person who is such a great person. You see, with this person who's of noble character. As I said, this verse 6:12 is very difficult. Tremper Longman, who's a well-known Old Testament scholar, he says, no one can speak with much certainty about its, verse 6:12, rendition or its interpretation. Okay, so I alert you to that. The verse is just very difficult. The translation that I've presented, it follows what an Old Testament scholar named Michael V. Fox and Ian Duguid, and you can see a parallel in the way the New Revised Standard Version translates it. Alternatives would be, it has set me over the chariots of my noble people. Well, what would that mean? In other words, in leading her to marry her love, her desire had elevated her in her estimation above royalty. So that would be one way of taking that particular translation. Another translation possibility, and some of these are textual too, and some there are textual judgments that you make, where you would say, well, instead of the Masoretic text, I think the original text is probably better represented in this early Syriac version called the Peshitta, okay, or Peshitta. All right, it has set me among the chariots of Amminadib. Now, Amminadib may be a pet name for her love, and you see this is part of why it's so difficult. Might be a pet name for her love, meaning something like my love is a prince. In that case, the clause means her desire brought her into his household, which is described from her perspective as being set among his chariots. All right, I just wanted you to be aware. How I've rendered that is debatable. But I think that what I have there, I think that's actually the way to go on it. That's what I see her saying. My desire has put me in the chariot of a noble man. It has brought me to union with him in marriage, and he's a great person. He's the person that word noble describes. All right, 6:13 to 7:9. The man says, turn, turn, O perfect one. Turn, turn, that we may gaze at you. How you gaze upon the perfect one, like on the dance of two camps. Not us. On the dance of two camps. How beautiful are your feet in sandals, O noble daughter. Now see, she uses noble. He uses noble for her. O noble daughter, the curves of your thighs are like jewels, the work of an artist's hands. Your navel is a round mixing bowl. May it never lack mixed wine. Your belly is a mound of wheat surrounded by lilies. Your two breasts are like two fawns, twins of a gazelle. Your neck is like a tower made of ivory. Your eyes are the pools in Heshbon by the gate of Bath Rabim. Your nose is like the Tower of Lebanon that looks toward Damascus. Your head crowns you like Mount Carmel. The hair of your head like purple cloth. A king could be held captive in your tresses. How beautiful and how pleasing you are, O love, with your delights. Your stature is like a palm tree, and your breasts are like its clusters. I say I will climb the palm tree and lay hold of its fruit. Oh, may your breasts be like clusters of the vine, and the scent of your breath like apples, and your palate like the best wine. Now the woman's going to cut in and finish that. But let me talk about this for a little bit here. Here he calls, the man calls his love, whom he labels the perfect one. Now many translations rendered Hashulamit as O Shulamite. But New English translation, Ian Duguid, commentator, they go with O perfect one. And that's what I'm seeing. That seems to me to fit how I feel the poem works. So I went that way. But the man calls his love, he labels her O perfect one, he calls her to turn so as to display her great beauty. Now I think in our culture, many women would say that's insulting, I'm not doing that. Certainly in this culture, he by no means is insulting her. He is praising her, and she would receive it as such. He's saying, you are so incredible. share your beauty with the people around you. And so this is what he's asking here. And then he comments on how transfixed the people are. They're absolutely spellbound. They gaze upon her as the dance of two camps. Or it could be they gaze on her as the Mahanaim. And that would be a place name. Okay, does it mean the two camps or does it mean this place name? Can't be sure. Okay, but they're obviously fixed on her. And this apparently, whether you take it as the dance of the two camps or you take it as this place, this is a refers to some kind of attention-riveting event or performance. That seems clear, you see. The specifics of which are lost to us. We don't know what is there about a dance of two camps that rivets people. Or the dance that involves this place. Was it known for something that has been lost? I don't know. And neither does anybody else. So, but the point is they are fixed. They are captured, captivated by her beauty. And then beginning in chapter 7, he launches into another description. Here, 7:1. He launches into another description of his love's great beauty. And this time he begins from her feet and he works up. He begins at her feet and he works up, maybe because she's turning or dancing. You see, drawing attention to her feet. Maybe that's why he starts there. And the word that's used here for her feet, it normally indicates feet in motion. Okay, so it may be, the compliment may refer to her gracefulness. That may be part of what he's saying about her, is that she, you know, she just moves, just really, just carries herself greatly. All of which is appealing to him. So maybe that's part of it. Now in calling her a noble daughter, as I mentioned, he's praising her the same way she praised him. You know, she has character. She has substance. She's just not, you know, she's just not eye candy. Although he would be quick to say, she's plenty of that. But that's not all she is. She's this person of tremendous depth and substance. Trevor Longman comments, he says, Nadir is a term of respect and endearment. It does not necessarily imply that the woman is noble by blood, but even if the term did imply that, in other words, that she was in royal lineage, he said, even if it did imply this, we would understand the appellation in the same way we understand king in reference to the man, although he's not royal. They are regal in each other's eyes. And so it's this idea of his perception of her that he's referring to and just praising her. Now he praises the curves of her thighs, which is the upper parts of her leg, which David, as Ian Dugwood notes, that includes her buttocks. So he's looking at her and he's praising her upper part, all around in here. And to him, they're extremely attractive. He says, like the curves of jewels formed by a master craftsman. So he's just looking at her. He says, there are some curves here that, you know, man, I don't know who's doing the designing. But, of course, he would know that. But he's just, he's praising her about this, that how she attracts him. When he says her navel is like a mixing bowl for wine. Now mixing bowl, that's where wine was made more pleasant, more pleasing by being mixed with sweeteners and aromatic scents in preparation for a feast. So they would take wine and they would mix it with some other things that would enhance the attractiveness of the wine or the enjoyment of the wine. And he wants that bowl to always be enticing to him. To always be filled with mixed wine. Your navel is a round mixing bowl. May it never lack mixed wine. I always want to be thrilled with you, is what this poet is saying, or this man in this poet is saying. Dugwood, Ian Dugwood, and Trevor Longman, and others, they suggest that navel includes, or perhaps is a euphemism for, part south. Okay, the center of male sexual satisfaction. Now, whether that's correct or not, I could understand that. But the description of her belly as a mound of wheat, I don't think many women today would find that appealing. You see? But that description there, it may refer to its natural, gentle protrusion, to its softness, if it's threshed or winnowed wheat, to its color. But certainly it is not intended in any way to be something negative about her. You see, it is part of a compliment. And the image of it being surrounded by lilies, so here he speaks of her belly, this gentle protrusion, soft, and he says it's surrounded by these lilies. That may hark back to chapter 6, verses 2 and 3, where there you see that sexual intimacy, it's there depicted as the man gathering lilies and grazing among the lilies. Well, if that's the case, then it refers, if that's what's being depicted by this, your belly is surrounded by these lilies, given how lilies are portrayed and what they symbolize in 6:2-3, if we're here talking about that sexual idea, well then it refers here probably to her breasts and the pubic area. You see these lilies, here's the belly, and then there are these lilies around it. And if it has this sexual sense to it that you see there, well, then he's bringing those things into play. These ideas that are part of sexual stimulation and fulfillment that are available in proximity to the belly. So I think that's what's being said. Now he continues moving his gaze upwards. He continues doing that. He moves upward to her breasts. As in chapter 4, verse 5, they're beautiful, they're symmetrical, like twin fawns. Her neck is slender, it's elegant, it's attractive, like an ivory tower. You see, so this is elegant, slender, beautiful. Her eyes are deep, clear, they're reflective, or they're shining, like the water in the cisterns at Heshbon, which presumably are located near the gate of Bath Rabin. Her nose is straight, like this famous Tower of Lebanon, and it provides a bearing of strength and confidence, which is what that Tower of Lebanon did. See, the Tower of Lebanon, it faced Damascus, which was the home of the Arameans, who were Israel's greatest enemy. So when he speaks of that, he's speaking about more than simply her physical attribute. He's speaking about what it connotes in terms of her strength and confidence. So she's just, I mean, you're talking the total package. I mean, of course, this is his perspective. He's bragging her up, but he's talking about how wonderful she is. He says her head crowns her appearance. It completes her beauty. She's just a knockout. It crowns her appearance as Mount Carmel crowns the surrounding area. So you have this area, then you have this feature that sticks up above this area and crowns it. And so he says that's her head. It's just striking in its beauty. In addition to her facial features, her hair is like purple cloth. That's a garment that's fit for royalty. And it's so lovely it could hold a king captive. And her hair is that, I mean, it's that great that it could hold a king captive. And verse 6, he extols her beauty generally and the pleasure that she provides him. And then he says that she has the stature of a palm tree, probably meaning she's tall and slender. So whatever he's talking about her belly, he's, you know, it's just, a normal, gentle protrusion. But here he refers to her as this palm tree, probably meaning she's tall and slender, and her breasts are represented as two clusters of grapes. You have a palm tree, grapes on a palm tree. But you have these two clusters. I must be getting flustered. You see, so, and as Ian Duguid says, in ancient iconography, date palms were often pictured with a pair of date clusters symmetrically on either side of the palm. Because we would look at that and go, why would you pick that? Well, you pick that because you've got the tree and these things are done in two symmetrical clusters, you see. So that's where the imagery comes from. Where he speaks of that. And the man declares his intention. He declares his intention to lay hold of her breasts, and his anticipation of the delight in doing so, as well as his anticipation of the delight of smelling her sweet breath, kissing her deeply, passionately. This is what all this is in here. The scent of your breath and your palate, like the best of wine. And then right after here, in the second part of verse 9, the woman then picks up. She breaks in and she finishes his statement about kissing her, about enjoying her mouth, like the best of wine. Well, the best of wine, you just savor it. It's just something wonderful. So that's what he's talking about, seeing these deep, passionate kisses. He's just going to be, oh, this is going to be great. Then she comes in. And she finishes saying, flowing smoothly for my love, gliding past the lips of sleepers. I am my love's, and his desire is for me. Now she finishes his sentence with her own expression of desire for his passionate kissing, that he mentioned, with the implied sexual intimacy that goes with it. You see, they're here and they're going after each other's mouths. I mean, this is, you know, so you have this implication here of that sexual intimacy. Now, many amend here. They amend the Masoretic text based on the Septuagint. You know, Septuagint is a Greek translation. And when I say they amend it, that means some people decide that they think the original text is better reflected in the Greek translation than the Masoretic text. Okay, so they say the Masoretic text here isn't the best representation of what the inspired writer originally wrote. So they go with the Septuagint, and they render it then past lips and teeth. So your translation may say that. But I do think the Masoretic text, the way I'm looking at it, is that it suggests that the passionate kisses that the man is talking about, the woman then picks up on, it suggests that the passionate kisses, they lead to sexual intimacy, perhaps repeatedly, which results in the lovers going to sleep. See, so the wine of passionate kisses glides past the lips of those who consequently end up sleeping through exhaustion. That's why I don't think it needs to be amended. I wouldn't amend it, because it does, in my judgment, make fine sense the way it sits. Now the woman then reflects contentedly that she belongs to her love. He owns her. And she's not worried about saying that. She belongs to him. He owns her in the sense he fully possesses her love, her loyalty, her body, and she owns him. As you see in chapter 6, verse 3. She owns him. Now here, instead of saying that he's hers, she says his desire is for her, and the implication being his desire is for her alone. His desire is for her alone. Theirs is a bond of true intimacy. There cannot be true intimacy that is shared with a third party. It cannot. You see, so this is what is being expressed. And this is what our world has worked so hard to dislodge, to change this truth, that the real living is in numbers and shallowness rather than in being monogamous and deeply invested and committed to one another. You see, even in our culture today, that message sounds strange. That message is the truth. Okay, whether you hear me or not, that message is the truth. And that's what I see just perking out of here. Now the woman continues in 7, 11, 8, 4. Come, my love, let us go to the countryside. Let us spend the night among the henna bushes. Let us rise early to go to the vineyards. Let us see if the vine has budded, if their blossoms have opened, if the pomegranates are in bloom. What are we looking for again here? Is the environment sensually sufficiently stimulative? Okay. Let us go and check these things out. There, I will give my caresses. Caresses, remember we talked about that? Sexual touching. I will give my caresses to you. The mandrakes send out their fragrance, and over our door is every delicacy, both new and old, which I have treasured up for you, my love. Oh, that you were my brother, who nursed at my mother's breasts. If I found you outside, I could kiss you. Surely none would despise me. I would lead you and bring you to the house of my mother who taught me. Am I like having a stroke, or is this thing bouncing? Oh my God, boy, yeah. What do I have here? Am I having a TIA? Or, yeah. I would give you spiced wine to drink, the nectar of my pomegranate. May his left hand be under my head and his right hand embrace me. I charge you, O daughters of Jerusalem, that you not stir up or awaken love until it pleases. Now in chapter 2, verses 10 to 16, you remember this is where the woman had declined her love's premature invitation to go away with him to the sensually stimulating countryside for fear of the temptation of that situation. In other words, the environment, she thought, the two of them alone, there, focused, in that environment would be too dangerous. And so she had sent him away. Well, as a married couple, it's now time to fully enjoy such sexual exploration. She invites her love to go with her for a night of lovemaking in the countryside. Having first risen early, and they got up early to confirm the romantic state of the environment. And she tells him there in the countryside, she will give her sexual caresses to him. Okay, meaning they will make love. Out here in this place that we've confirmed is this sensual environment. Mandrakes, as you probably know, they were considered an aphrodisiac in the ancient Near East, and you can get a hint of that in Genesis chapter 30, verses 14 to 16. So the statement about the mandrakes sending out their fragrance, you see, that indicates that the couple's eager for sexual intimacy. And the woman implies in verse 13 that their get-together in the countryside will involve both old and new pleasures, things she's kept for him. My judgment, she's steaming her husband up. You see, I saw this before when I think she said, well, I've taken off my tunic, dear. You know, there's no way I can, you know, I'm just sitting here. What can I do? I think she's still, you know, I got some stuff in mind, is what she's saying to her husband. I've got some stuff here. And then in chapter 8, verse 1, the scene, it shifts from the countryside now to the city. And her desire for him is so great that she can barely stand the social restriction on public displays of affection, even between married couples. You see, there were social restrictions on public displays of affection, even between married couples, and that restriction is killing her. She's so into him that seems burdensome to her. Now, this would be of no concern in the privacy of the countryside. There's nobody there. Okay, so what you're doing out there, but in the city, it now would be a thing where that social norm would come into play and act and create its restraint. She said, look, if he were her brother, she could kiss him in public and nobody would complain. You see, they wouldn't complain because that was socially acceptable. So that's what this talks about. Of course, she could not kiss her brother in an erotic way. That's not what she's talking about. But she so longs to kiss him and to be with him and to have this public display of affection, she finds the social restriction against it in the city. It's chafing her here. And she says, if you were my brother, I could kiss you and nobody would say anything about it. You know? So, but as I say, she couldn't kiss him like she would kiss her husband. But that's not the point she's making. She's just expressing her desire to be able to kiss him on the streets. That's what she wants to be able to do. And having begun with the public kisses that she fantasizes she could enjoy, if he were her brother. She leads her love into her mother's house, where she then gives herself to him sexually. That's the spiced wine and the nectar of the pomegranate. And lest there be any question about her desire and intention, verse 3 makes express her longing for his sexual embrace. You see, may his left hand be under my head and his right hand embrace me. As I said before when this came up, under my head, she's lying down. So there's no, you know, this is what she is speaking about in her mother's house. That itself has sexual connotations because it's a place of privacy. It's a place of security. And it's a place of the previous generation's romantic liaison. Right? That's where they got started. So you see it carries these same sexual connotations. And in verse 4, the woman again declares the power of love. See, including the sexual attraction that's part of it. It's so great that it's unwise to rev that up before it can be satisfied. I mean, it's so great that even in marriage, it can produce frustration here through this social restriction against public displays of affection. You can imagine the difficulty and hardship it could produce if allowed to reach a boil without the satisfaction and release that are available in the bond of marriage. How many young people have not listened to this, have not heeded this, have not recognized the power of passion, the power of love, I said weeks ago, wind up getting themselves into situations that I say you'd have to be a spiritual giant not to compromise. You see, there. I mean, this, you're playing with something powerful, and you have to respect it. And that's what I liked when before when the woman said, no, I recognize that. You see, I recognize that. And here we get in 8:5, you have the daughters of Jerusalem. Who is this coming up from the wilderness leaning on her love? Under the apple tree, the woman that speaks says, under the apple tree, I awakened you. There your mother conceived you. There she who bore you was in labor. Set me like a seal on your heart, like a seal on your arm. For love is as strong as death, jealousy as fierce as Sheol. Its flames are flames of fire, a mighty flame. Many waters cannot extinguish love, rivers cannot sweep it away. If a man offered for love all the wealth of his house, he would be utterly despised. See, the bond of marriage, it's depicted here in the image of the woman approaching the city leaning on her love. See, there's no longer any distance between them. They're no longer separate. She's come, she's approaching, she's leaning on her love. They're connected. And then the second part of verse 5, the woman speaks to her husband of their lovemaking, saying she awakened him under the apple tree, meaning she sexually aroused him. They had just been out in the countryside in the poem. She sexually aroused him. It's the same word in the repeated warnings to the daughters of Jerusalem not to stir up or awaken love until it pleases. So when she says she awakened him under the apple tree, she sexually aroused him. That's what she's talking about. She says the sexual intimacy in which they engaged under the apple tree was the same act, the location standing for the act. It's the same act through which his mother and every other mother, for that matter, had conceived, which conception resulted in his birth. Now the point seems to be here with this talk about the there she who bore you was in labor. At least it seems to me that the point here is that the sexual relationship in marriage, as exciting and as enjoyable as that is designed to be, it goes beyond their pleasure. And it's tied to the great blessing of children and the continuance of the family line. See, so it's like all this and that too? And children too? Yeah. Children too. So that's what I think is going on. Verse 6, the woman expresses her desire to be a seal on the man's heart, her husband's heart. on his heart and on his arm. And seals, of course, they were marks of ownership. They were marks of personal identification. So the woman's telling the man she wants to own his heart and his actions. She wants first place in his life in terms of human relationships. A devotion and a commitment that is shared with no one else. That is the essence of the marriage bond. A devotion and a commitment that is shared by no one else. The two of you. That's it. Nobody comes in between. It's the two of us. And that's what she's after. She wants that supremacy because that's the nature of spousal love. That's what it is. It holds one to another with a strength that's comparable to the strength with which death holds its victims. It's that powerful. And the jealousy which comes with it guards its object with the fierceness that is comparable to how Sheol, which is the realm of the dead, guards its inhabitants. Let me read to you what Trumper Longman says. There are two relationships described in the Bible where jealousy is a potentially appropriate reaction. The divine-human relationship and the marriage relationship. These are the only two relationships that are considered exclusive. Humans can have only one God. And you remember behind all of this? This is the big backdrop is this is a metaphor for God's relationship with his people. Christ's relationship with his church. You see, that's the big backstory. It's about human love and what God intends for humans to experience in marriage. It's an ideal of that, but it's also this backdrop. Let me finish this quote here. He says, humans can have only one God. If they worship another, it triggers God's jealousy. God's jealousy is an energy that tries to rescue the relationship. Similarly, a man and a woman can have only one spouse. If there is a threat to that relationship, then jealousy is a proper emotion. Anybody who's not jealous, if somebody's moving in on his wife or husband, well, I'm too spiritual to be jealous. No, you're missing the point. You don't understand the nature of the marriage relationship. You see, that's righteous in that situation to have this response. If there's a threat to that relationship, then jealousy is a proper emotion. All this is because so much hangs on the integrity of the relationship. It is so basic, so deep, that it stirs strong emotions and passions. And this is what this woman is saying. She's talking to him about that. I heard that bell. Thanks for